gets out of the boat, just jumps out of the boat and starts to go after Jesus and goes to shore. How much do we want him? This is the part that Jesus showed me. How much do you want him? Do you want him enough that whenever he blesses you, you are willing to leave that blessing and go and worship him?
Hi, this is Pastor Ken from Vineyard of Hope in Osawatomie, Kansas. My prayer for you today is that God would touch your heart in a real and tangible way for a breakthrough in your life as you hear this message. Thank you for watching, and I want to give you a personal invitation to come and see what we're all about. The church information is at the end of this video. Now I hope you enjoy this message. God bless.
Somebody blessed me with this amazing devotion that I am. I love it. It's like it's just awesome. And so this message sparked out of this, and also from God, one day of just diving in deeper. And it's amazing what the Word of God can do, and how it is a double-edged sword, and it cuts through everything, our sin and everything in us, and it reveals our true self. And I've been at such an intimate area of God lately, that he's removing things out of my life that I've noticed that I've had so far deep down inside. And I'm so thankful that it's awesome. Like, even though that it's rough at some parts of the day, I'm still trusting in God through it. And it's not easy, you know, giving a message. There's not a lot of people here, but it's still nerve-wracking, just so you all know. But I had a question come to mind. One day I was driving to work, and I was just in prayer. And I remember, and I just kind of heard it, and it said, "How much do you want me?" But it was more like, "How much do you want it?" And I was like, "Is that you, God?" You know? And I was driving and praying, and then I heard it later on that day. And it was like, "How much do you want it?" And I was like, "What? How much do you want?" I'm like, "Okay, all right." So I'm reading in the Word, and I'm like, "Okay, all right, where am I supposed to go?" And then I remember there was one, it was a couple more mornings later, a few more mornings later, and he said, "How much do you want me?" And I was like, "Okay, I want you a lot." But I couldn't get all the words out. How much do I want God? So digging in deeper, and every single day that my devotion, it took me more, and it was just revealing me through my devotion every single part of how much do you want me, and it was just added on every single day, and I actually had more pages than this. And I was sitting at work yesterday, and I was like, "Where do I go, God? Where do I go? What am I supposed to do?" And I had like 3 pages on one side and 2 pages on the other. So I was like, "This is too much. I need direction. I need clarity, God." And today, it was right before I was leaving, and I believe this is just exactly where I'm supposed to go. So that's my question: is how much do you want him? And I hope, I pray, God, that you would just speak through me. So, because that's what I got through this. So I hope I can just put this out in the same way that you showed me. But yeah, how much do you want him?
A whole lot.
A whole lot. Awesome. I want him a whole lot too. I want him so much.
I want him every minute of every day.
Yeah, every minute, every second, every moment. I want Jesus. I want to experience Jesus so much. The tangible evidence of him, and I can feel his presence right now. But I want to be with him. You know, that's how much I want him. So I hope I can portray that. So I am going to jump a lot because these are all, they all kind of tie together, but I want to show you this. So if you have your Bibles, go to Matthew 5:6 with me. I'm going to primarily read out of NIV because that's where I've just been studying at. But I have the first one, it's in Amplified just because it goes in so much detail. And this one's just going to be really quick, and it says, "Blessed, joyful, nourished by God's goodness, are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness." And in parentheses here, it says, "Those who actively seek right standing with God, for they will be completely satisfied." How much do you want him? How much do you want God? How much do you want Jesus? Are you actively seeking Jesus? Are you just coming to church and sitting in a pew? every Sunday, every Wednesday or Tuesday that you may come, or Thursday, or are you going someplace else? Or are you just waking up and then going through life? Because I've done it and it doesn't work. Just going through the motions, that doesn't work. I want Jesus. I have to actively seek Him. If I want Him more, I have to actively seek Him. There's so much that I haven't been able to do that. We say, it's just a taste. If I've just tasted it, I want more of a taste. Right? What's the point of just tasting something and then just going on? No, I like to eat. Me and Pastor Ken are really, I do. And I've noticed I've been gaining a lot of weight lately. Praise the Lord. That's good. So I'm getting that. And, you know, also just good food lately because my wife cooks good. Anyways, okay. Those who actively seek right standing with God. I'm seeking God right now. No matter what the enemy is throwing at me, we still continue to seek Him. So I just wanted to throw that one out there. Let's now go to Luke 9. Verse 57, and just kind of, you know, if you write that down, how much do you want Him? How much do I want Him? If you write it down or say it in your head, how much do I want Him? And I want you to just kind of think about that. So starting in verse 57, the title of this is The Cost of Following Jesus. I was there walking along the road in verse 57, chapter 9, as they were walking along the road, a man said to Him, I will follow you wherever you go. And Jesus replied to him, foxes have dens and birds have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head. So he said to another man, follow me. But he replied, Lord, first let me go and bury my father. And Jesus said to him, let the dead bury their own dead. But you go proclaim the kingdom of God. And still another said, I will follow you, Lord, but first let me go back and say goodbye to my family. And Jesus replied, no one puts a hand to the plow and then looks back is fit for the service of the kingdom of God. This isn't easy, but what I got from this is Jesus saying to these men who are just like, Lord, first let me go take care of my father while he's dying, and then I'm gonna come and follow you. And Jesus is like, no, I want you now. How much do you want him? Every time that I've read this, and I've read Luke 9, 57 through 62 over and over, and I hear that over and over again, how much do you want me? Do you want me enough that you're just going to follow me immediately? Or are you too busy with everything else in your life? Like work, are you too worried about your work that you don't make enough time to follow me? It's not that we don't always have enough time, it's that we don't make enough time all the time. And so Jesus says, let the dead bury their own dead. You go proclaim the kingdom of God. Proclaim the kingdom of God. He's coming again. He came and he's coming again. And this other man, he says, I'll follow you, Lord, but first let me go back and say goodbye to my family. He's like, that's not the point. It's about us. And it hit me in a hard place, and I'm like, well, God, what about my family? What about, you know? And that's important for me to build up my family because I'm the spiritual leader of my home. But also, I can't forget about myself. I can't forget to be on my knees and say, God, I love you, and pray to Him daily. And that's why he was asking, how much do you want me? Do you want me enough that you're just going to go through life, or are you just going to, are you actually really going to follow me? Are you really going to seek me? So this first one is, do you want him enough that you're willing to give up your family and seek him more? Are you willing to give up that time and make time to follow him? Now let's go to Mark chapter 14. I told you I'm going to jump over, but a little bit all over the place. But it says in verse 27, and this is Jesus, and he's talking to Peter and the other disciples, but primarily Peter right here. And he says, you will fall away, Jesus told them, for it's written, I will strike the shepherd and the sheep will scatter. But after I have risen, I will go ahead of you into Galilee. If you got a highlighter, mark that part right there. But after I have risen, I will go ahead of you into Galilee. And Peter declared, even if all fall away, I will not. Okay? Even if all fall away, I will not. And Jesus says to him, truly I tell you, today, yes, tonight, before the rooster crows twice, you yourself will disown me three times. But Peter insisted emphatically, even if I have to die with you, I will never disown you. That's a pretty bold statement. Even if I have to die with you, I will never disown you. I know there's been times in my life where I'm like, God, I'm not going to go back and do this again. I'm not going to go back and do it again. And I've done it again. I'm not going to go and do this, Lord, but I've done it. I'm going to make time here, God, and I don't do it. I'm going to get up at 5 o'clock in the morning every single day, and I'm going to pray, God, and I don't do it. When are we going to start? This is what he was telling me. When are you going to actually stop telling me what you're going to do and start doing it? You know? So going on here, in verse 32, down at, now they're at the Gethsemane, if I can say that right. So they went to the place called Gethsemane, and Jesus said to his disciples, sit here while I pray. Okay, so he tells them something specific to do. Sit here while I pray. And he took Peter, James, and John, so specifically three along with him, and began to be deeply distressed and troubled. He said, my soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. And he said to them, stay here and keep watch. This is the second time. Stay here, keep watch. Sit here. He tells the other disciples, sit here while I pray. And then he tells Peter, James, and John, sit here and keep watch for me. So it says he goes a little bit farther and he fell to the ground and prayed that if possible, the hour might pass from him. He said, Abba, Father. He said, everything is possible for you. Take this cup from me, yet not what I will, but what you will. So I want to stop right there really quick. In verse 35, this is going a little bit farther. Jesus went farther. Jesus, it says that we're supposed to be in the likeness of Christ. And Jesus gives us an example all throughout the gospel. And for me, it was a lot in Mark this last couple weeks. But here, it says that Jesus went a little bit farther. In the devotion, what I was reading, it said that with that, we're sometimes too afraid to go a little bit farther. You know, do we want God? Do we want Jesus so much more that we're willing to stay up a little bit later and pray? Or are we too worried about, oh, I have to be up at 5 o'clock in the morning or 4 or 3? But God, I have this person on my heart, but I'm too tired right now, so I'm just going to go to sleep. Or God, I've got this to do and this to do and this to do and this to do. So I really don't have enough time right now to read your word. So I don't know why I'm just kind of sorry. I'll come back to you later. But do we ever come back to him? Do we really want him that much that we'll say, you know what? This is taken care of. I can get to that later. This is taken care of. I can get to that later. I'm going to take time and read really what's important, because we all, at the end, have the account to come before him. And he says, either well done, thy good and faithful servant, or depart from me, I never knew you. Those are very impactful words, but sometimes we take those like a grain of salt. Of just, well, God, if I come to church on Sunday, it's going to be all right. I'll be good. I'll get into heaven. I don't want to just get into heaven. There's parts in the Word of God that I haven't even touched yet. My eyes haven't even came across yet. I want it more. I'm being honest. There's parts in this Bible that I haven't looked at yet, but I want it more. And we have to make the time to want it more. We have to make the time to get in it, to get it more. It says the Word is the bread of life for us. This is our food. It's living water. If we're thirsty, this is our drink. But sometimes we're like, oh, it's too physical. God, I'm thirsty, but I'm going to just give in. God, I'm hungry, so I'm just going to give in a little bit. You know, so how much do you want Him? Do you want Him enough that you're going to fast? Because Jesus says, when His disciples couldn't cast out the demons and the people came to Him, and Jesus said, this kind can only come out by prayer and fasting. Some things that we've put down so far in us, or they're locked inside of us, they can only come out with prayer and fasting. I've had to take times out of my day, whether it's the morning of just, God, I'm giving my morning to You and I'm fasting. And I'm not saying that boastful. I'm just saying that I have had to do that, and I've seen change. So that's what we're supposed to do. Give account, right? And it's happened. It works. That stuff goes away. I made that time possible. We have to do it. How much do you want Him? How much do you want Him? Are you willing to give Him a breakfast, a lunch, or a dinner? That time that it's in that moment, that's either for Jesus or yourself. And it can either go away, and that was yourself. I'll give an example really quick. It was about 2 weeks ago on a Tuesday night, I think. No, it wasn't Tuesday. It was a Thursday night. And because I was here on Tuesday. And I'm laying in bed, and I open up my phone, and I don't have it. It's over there. I open up my phone, and I'm like, okay, I can get on my Bible app. And I was, you know, trying to study this. All right. I was like, I can get on my Bible app, and I can read Mark chapter 9. And then I was like, I swipe over one screen, and there's the YouTube app right there. And I click on that. I ended up watching YouTube videos for 2 hours. And then look at my phone, and I'm like, oh, wow, it's 11 o'clock. I'm a horrible person, God. And I beat myself up that night. And then in the morning, I woke up, and he was like, you're not a horrible person. You just didn't make that time for me. That time's gone. You're never going to remember that. What did you watch last night? And I was like, well, I watched this and this. He's like, that doesn't even touch to what you actually watched on there. Like, all, you know, I watched so much, but I can only remember a few things. That time is so, it's not important at all. Our time with God is more important. I could have taken that time and given that time to God and took His word. But you know what's awesome is He didn't be like, Tyler, you're a horrible person. He's like, fix it. All you have to do is follow Me. Just don't do it again. So what did I do? I deleted the app off of my phone. Praise God. I don't have it on my phone anymore. But that doesn't mean I don't still have a temptation to try to get it on there, like on my internet. But anyways, that's just a side note. It's our time is so important. And how much do we want Him? Are we willing to give Him up our time, all of our time, to really seek Him? Because we only have so much time here. And that time is so important. I remember Kenny, he told me, and he said this to a bunch of people, but I remember the first time he told me this. He said, God wants your time, your talent, and your money. Those are good. Those are three important things that we don't want to give up. I remember that. We don't want to give up, but God wants them, and He does. He wants our time, He wants our talents, and He wants our money. And we all have time, we all have a talent, and we all have money of some sort, right? Even if it's a penny. But so anyways, moving on here. That was just a little. So yeah, Jesus went a little bit farther and fell to the ground. He went farther. He was to this point. He says, I'm so overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. And He's like, I don't have anything else except to seek You, Father. And are we like that? And I had that happen one night. God, am I at this point that I want You? Not right now, but I'm trying, God. So I'm giving more time and more time. I'm taking time out of my day right now to give to Him. And I've sectioned off an hour for my lunch and devotion and reading the Word of God, because I want Him more. I want Him more. So, Abba, Father, in verse 35, everything is possible. You take this cup from Me, yet not what I will, but what You will. So then In verse 37, it says, "Then he returned to his disciples and found them sleeping." "Simon," he said to Peter, "are you asleep? Couldn't you keep watch for 1 hour?" So that just tells us he's gone for an hour and he's already fell asleep because he's just so tired. It wasn't in him of just like, hey, Jesus is leaving after he's already told them multiple times. This is late in the book of Mark. And he's already told them a couple times and predicted his death and said, "I'm leaving. Prepare yourself. Get ready." And they're falling asleep. Not to say anybody's falling asleep in here, but, you know, do we want him that much, you know? How much do you want him? Peter, I don't know what was going through his mind right there, so I don't want to give my own opinion on it, but he was falling asleep. It wasn't important. He had also rebuked him earlier, and he said, and I think it was Luke, and he said, "Your concerns are not of this world," whenever he said, "Get behind me, Satan. Your concerns are not of this world, they're of this world." It wasn't Jesus calling Peter a horrible person. He was just like, no, change. You're not thinking about eternal things. You're thinking about of this world, and that's it. Because he said, I'm going to die. And he's told him multiple times, and he gets to this part, and he's falling asleep. I would go on a little bit farther here. So, couldn't you keep watch for 1 hour? In verse 38, "Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation." If y'all know what happens with Peter, he denies Jesus. "Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation." He gave him his way out. And then he says, "The spirit is willing, but your flesh is weak." It's like, your spirit wants me, but your flesh doesn't want me that much. And I've felt like this. I've felt where I'm like, God, I really want you, but I am exhausted. Physically exhausted, and I've given up, and I've went to sleep instead of where I have just a little bit of energy, instead of saying, God, give me the energy to just seek you right now in this moment. But I'm working on it. So, moving on here. "Once more, he went away and prayed the same thing that he had just prayed. And when he came back again, he found them sleeping because their eyes were heavy." So the second time, he came back and they were sleeping again. They did not know what to say to him. So they're just like, sorry. He knows everything, right? So returning that third time, he said to them, "Are you sleeping and resting? Enough! The hour has come. Look, the Son of Man is delivered into the hands of sinners." At that point, that's whenever they came and they took him. He was trying to give them a way out. "Stay with me. Watch and pray. Because I'm going to be leaving. But if you remember, I said, I'll go ahead of you into Galilee." But in all that, in Luke chapter 9, in Mark 14, I really felt like Jesus is simply saying, follow me. All you have to do is follow me. Where he said to the other man, in the cost of following Jesus, follow me. That's all he says, simple. Follow me. It's simple. And I got what I told you earlier. I don't want you to tell me. I want you to do it. I don't want you to just tell me everything that you want to do, Tyler. This is what him talking to me. I don't want you to tell me everything that you want to do. I want you to do it. How many times have we heard Pastor Ken say that same exact thing? How many times do we follow through? I failed a time or two. How much do you want to do it? How much do you want him? I'm going to get up at 5 o'clock in the morning and I wake up at 6 o'clock every single day. Are you going to make the time to do it? Are you going to do it? Are you going to give? Let's talk about that. Are you willing to give him what's his? Well, God, all I have is 10 bucks left. What do you need to buy with the 10 bucks? Are your bills paid? Yes, my bills are paid right now, God. Is your rent paid? Yes, my rent's paid right now. Have you paid tithe? Yeah. What do you do? Give it to him. There's a story of a woman, and all she brings is 2 coins that says less than a few cents. And all these other men, they come in and they bring loads of bukus of money. And Jesus is sitting there watching them as everybody drops in. And this woman just little lady, she comes and drops in just a few coins, and he says, I tell you, this woman's amount is so much more worth, and we'll get her into the kingdom of God. This is so much more worth everything else that all these other, not that it wasn't a good amount of money, but it was in her heart. I gave everything because I don't have anything else to lose. What else do I have to lose, God? What else do I have to lose? I failed in this area last year, but I'm not doing it anymore. I don't want to. I want to give him everything. And I am. I'm giving him. We only have a few bucks right now. That's okay. Actually, we don't have any bucks right now, but that's okay. But we're going to give him everything we can. We still have time and talents, right? So we're going to give him our time and we're going to give him our talents. How much do we want it? Do you care more about your money than you do about God? Because you can't serve them both. Do you care more about sports than you care about God? You can't serve them both. Do you care more about your job than you do about God? We can't serve them both. You care more about your family than you do about God. You can't serve them both. You can't worship them both. God deserves all of our worship. Our family, we love them. But it's said in the Word multiple times, I've come to bring a sword. I haven't come to bring you all together in perfect harmony. But there's going to be a time where father against son, daughter against, not that we want that to happen, but Jesus said it was going to happen. I don't want that to happen in my family, but I can't worship my son. I worship my God and I love my son. I worship my God and I love my wife. I worship my God and I love my daughter. But I cannot serve them both. I cannot worship them both. How much do you want God? How much do you want Jesus? Do you want him enough that you're going to give him everything that's his? Do you want him enough that you're going to give all your time to him? That you're going to be here whenever you can because this is what you need? Do you want him enough that you're going to make it here even if it's a few minutes late because you got out late from work? Do you want him enough that you're going to read the word even if it doesn't make sense for the moment because it will make sense in the future? At first, whenever I started reading, I didn't know what I was reading. But after I started reading, this is the most amazing thing in the world, in the universe, because he filled it with his glory, the whole universe. So, I've got one last part here that's a little bit lengthy, but I'll get through it quickly. I want you to turn to the last chapter of John. It's chapter 21. And this chapter is amazing. It's a beautiful chapter to me. And God revealed something to me in this chapter on my way to work on Monday. And I love my time with God in the morning whenever I can just seek him in my car. It doesn't matter where it's at. Seek God. It doesn't matter. How much you want him is going to determine how much you put into it. There was something I had taken off of here. And it was how much, if you want him enough, what did I put on there? How much you want him will determine how you will stay strong. That's what it was. You know, we've talked about start strong, stay strong, end strong. We started strong. I want to stay strong. And I want to end strong. End this year, going into next year stronger. Right? I know what it's like to not end strong. And some of us do know what it's like to not end strong. But let's do it different. Let's stay strong. Let's seek him. Let's get in our word. Let's read our word like we haven't read our word before. Let's pray like we haven't prayed before. Let's give like we haven't given before. Not so we can make a mansion, but so we can give God what's his, really his. Let's fast, because that's what His Word calls us to do. So John chapter 21. I love this. This is so good. And I don't want to get ahead of myself. I love this. All right, so afterward, Jesus appeared again to His disciples by the Sea of Galilee. Now, if y'all remember, had y'all marked that, if you had a mark, Mark 14:20, and I'm going to read that real quick. It says, "But after I have risen, I will go ahead of you into Galilee." That's pretty good stuff right there. He said He was going to do it. All right. So afterward, Jesus appeared again to His disciples by the Sea of Galilee. He told them He was going to do it, and He did it. It happened this way. So Simon Peter, Thomas, also known as Didymus, Nathanael from Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two other disciples were together. "I'm going out to fish," Simon Peter told them. And they said, "Well, we'll go with you." This is how I was reading it, so I'm just going to read it how I read it, okay? So they went out and got in the boat. But that night, they caught nothing. So they're just sitting out in their boat. This is good. All right, so I just told you that. Jesus appeared, He told them He was going to, and He did it. All right. Early in the morning, Jesus stood on the shore, but the disciples did not realize that it was Jesus. Pastor Ken's talked to us about this, about, in the times when they weren't... whenever He had risen, they couldn't recognize Him at certain times. So that He was on the shore and they couldn't recognize Him. So I picture them being a pretty decent, distance from the shoreline, and they're just like, man, it's morning, maybe there's fog or something, but they couldn't recognize that it's Jesus, but they just know that there's a man there. And He goes, it says here, "Friends, haven't you any fish?" But I got to say, "Hey, have you guys caught any fish yet?" And they said, "No." He said, "Well, throw your net on the right side of the boat and you'll find some." So there, I just imagine in my head, they're like, "Oh, all right, whatever. This dude probably doesn't know what he's talking about." And they throw it over, they do it, and they can't even pull up the amount of fish. All right? When they did, they were unable to haul the net in because of the large number of fish. And this is the part right here in verse 7. "Then the disciple whom Jesus loved, who was John, said to Peter, 'It's the Lord.'" They couldn't recognize Him. But whenever they tried to haul this in after the man just said, "Hey, toss your net on the other side, you'll get some fish." And they start to pull it in. And John's like, "It's the Lord." And Peter, as soon as Simon Peter heard him say, "It is the Lord," he wrapped his outer garment around him, for he had taken it off, jumped into the water after him. Isn't that awesome? Well, the part that gets me so much is because who was the one that said, "Hey, let's go out to fish"? Peter. The one thing that he went in to do, he left. Because he knew what was the most important thing. That came to me on Monday morning, and I was like, whoa! He left them. He didn't care. That he was... He went to bring it all up, and John goes, "It's the Lord." And he's like, "Whatever, guys. I don't need that. I don't need the fish. I don't need the fish." So he gets his cloak on. I was reading something there saying it's probably out of reverence that he did it, but that's beside the point. He gets out of the boat, just jumps out of the boat and starts to go after Jesus and goes to shore. How much do we want Him? This is the part that Jesus showed me. How much do you want Him? Do you want Him enough that whenever He blesses you, you are willing to leave that blessing and go and worship Him? Like, do you want Him or do you want His blessings? His blessings are great and they happen all the time because He loves us. But do you want Him? Because I want Him. I want Him more than I want blessings. The songs are beautiful, but they're going to pass away. You probably don't even remember what I said earlier. That's okay. I don't care. I care that you want Jesus. Because I want Jesus. I want Jesus more than fish. I want Jesus more than money. I want Jesus more than my job. I want to see Him face to face. I'm shaking. Literally. I want Jesus. That's what Jesus wants. Peter was so excited that he jumped out of the boat. He left the thing that he went out to do, that he said, let's go fish. They didn't know what else to do. Aren't we like that too? Whenever we see God, this was the second time Jesus showed up. Or the third time, I mean, sorry. This is the third time Jesus showed up. So he already showed up to them twice before in their house. And this time it was out in the open. And wow. Haven't some of us sometimes tasted and experienced God in an amazing way, but yet we still go back and do the things that we've done in the past because we don't know what else to do, but we should just keep pursuing Him. Right? I will pursue you. I will pursue your presence. Are we going to just sing the songs on Sunday? Are we going to really mean them in our hearts? You know? Do we just want to come and just have a party with each other? Or do we want to come and have a party with Jesus? How much do you want Him? This is a question He's asked me every single day. How much do you want me, Tyler? And it's grown more and more. I want you so much. I want to be with you right now. I want you. I'm here last night. And I'm like, God, I don't know where I'm supposed to go in this message, but I know that you're going to give me the words to say because your word says that you'll give me the words to say in the moment. You'll bring it back to account. So I don't know, but it all came out right. Praise the Lord. But man, how much do you want Him? Man. So then the other disciples, they brought the net full of fish. Peter went back and helped them out because he's just a good guy like that. But I want to go down to verse 15. And in verse 15 of chapter 21, he says, when they had finished eating, because he had had them for breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of John. And you notice he didn't call him Peter. Simon. That was his first name. Do you love me more than these? He says, yes, Lord. You know that I love you. I'd answer the same question this week. Yes, Lord, I love you. And so he said, okay, feed my lambs. And again, Jesus said, Simon, son of John, do you love me? And he answered, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. Okay, take care of my sheep. And then a third time, he said to him, Simon, son of John, do you love me? And Peter was hurt because Jesus asked him the third time, do you love me? He said, Lord, you know all things. I think of the Psalm 139. It says, you've searched me and you've known me. You know when I sit and when I rise. You know everything about me. You formed me in my mother's womb. You know all my inmost being. You know everything about me. And so he says, you know all things, because he does. You know that I love you. And Jesus said, okay, feed my sheep. Very truly I tell you, when you were younger, you dressed yourself and you went where you wanted. But when you're older, you'll stretch out your hands and someone else will dress you and they'll lead you where you do not want to go. And Jesus said this to indicate this kind of death that he had by Peter, by which Peter would glorify God. Then he said to him, follow me. And I hear this same question. How much do you want me, Peter? How much do you want me? Stop telling me and do it. If you notice, he did. After Peter denied him three times, he affirmed his love for him three times over. But he also gave him action. He said, if you love me, then you'll feed my lambs, then you'll feed my sheep, and you'll take care of my sheep. How much do you want him? Do you want him enough that you're going to stop saying that you're going to do things and actually do it? That's what I heard him say. This is for your church. How much do you want him? Because I want him a bunch. My flesh is weak, but God, his spirit is strong in me. And I want him so much that I'm willing to give everything. Now, I can't just say it. I have to mean it, and I have to do it. So it's kind of, if we want to stay strong, we've got to stop just saying the words and actually doing it. We've got to stop saying, Jesus, I'm going to do this, and not do it. We have to mean it in our hearts. Sorry. We have to mean it in our heart. We don't have to tell the whole world about it. We just have to do it. Yeah, just do it. Right? So, don't just tell me that you want me. Show me that you want me. That's what I heard through the church. Show him that you want him. But I just kind of feel like we're just supposed to give it to him tonight. Give that to him. And really mean that. And stop just saying it, but actually do it. From now on. We're going to stay strong and we're going to end strong. And if you don't want to stay strong, we're going to move on. We are. Sorry. That's what Pastor Ken's been preaching to us all for this first past 3 months. If you don't want it, just move back. If you want him, let's do this.
That's right.
Yeah. So, Lord, let's all, you can just stay there. Jesus. Lord, we love you so much. Man. We love you so much. You're so wonderful. Lord, forgive us for not following through in our past. And Lord, forgive us for saying the things but not following through, not finishing. And Lord, I pray that right now, in Jesus' name, that you would just wipe that all away. And Lord, I pray that you would give us boldness. I pray that you would unite us, Lord, with a peace that passes all understanding that comes from Jesus. Unite your church here in Osawatomie. You've called this church to do great things. I remember that. I remember you saying all the things that you told me were going to happen, and they have. And the one thing that I'm still seeing and waiting on is saying this, you're going to do great things here. And I remember that. And we're seeing great things, but Lord, we want more. So Lord, I pray that we would have the boldness and courage to really mean it. And that we would seek you, Lord, in the times that we don't want to, that we would pray in the times that we don't feel like it, that we would fast in the times that we just want to give up, that we would give whenever we don't have anything else. Lord, and that we would seek you over everything, that we would seek you over everything on this world, that we wouldn't fix our eyes on things of this world, that we would fix our eyes on you, Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith. Perfect our faith and strengthen us in the name of Jesus. We all pray and agree. Amen. Amen. Man.